Good morning. Let's all stand and sing. Praise God. 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 Know ye that the Lord, He is God. It is He that hath made us, and not we ourselves. We are His people and the sheep of His pasture. Enter into His gates with thanksgiving, and into His courts with praise. Be thankful unto Him, and bless His name. For the Lord is good, His mercy is everlasting, and His truth endureth to all generations. Praise God. 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 Please be seated.
Good morning. Welcome to Southwest Church of Christ. Glad you're here. Thank you for getting up out of bed, getting dressed. Especially thank you for getting dressed. Thank you for getting here and being a part of our worship today. If you're visiting with us, I hope you'll come back at any time. If you're visiting with us, you are our special guest, and we're glad you're here today. We are also grateful for our regular members, and just glad you're here today. Let me read this passage to you. He says, "Rejoice in the Lord always. I'll say it again, rejoice. Let your gentleness be evident to all. The Lord is near. Do not be anxious about anything, but in every situation, by prayer and petition with thanksgiving, present your requests to God, and the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus." Let's pray together. Father, thank you for being with us today. Thank you for your Son. And as we just sang, we praise you for all that you have done, not only for us, but for the world. And so we thank you for blessings. We thank you for our homes. We thank you for the food that we eat. We thank you for all the physical blessings we have. But Father, more importantly, we thank you for all the spiritual blessings. Father, we just pray that you would be with us. In Jesus' name, amen. We always do a special prayer after the welcome, and I couldn't think of anything more special than our birthdays. Any kids have birthdays in September? Everybody's a little, I promise I won't hug you or get close to you. September birthdays, come on up. Going once? All right, I knew you would, guys. How you doing? Did he make you come, or did you make him come? Or no, okay. Now, I know you guys will talk but you don't have to up here. I'm sure, oh, there's another one. Come on up. Come on up. Happy birthday this month. How old will you be?
Five.
Five? My goodness, where has the time gone? You look very pretty today, and so do you. Well, let's pray for these that have come up, have been brave enough to come up, okay? Father, we have a number of blessings, and we've already listed a number of blessings, but one of the greatest blessings this church has is the blessing of young people. In this month of September, this beginning of fall month, we thank you for these three precious ones and for everybody else who has a birthday in the month of September. We pray that you would watch over them, help us as your people, as your church, to be fathers and mothers and aunts and uncles and grandfathers and grandmothers, aunts and uncles. Help us to always watch over these precious, precious kids. And Father, we pray that we will not lose a one. And we thank you for them, and we ask that you bless them. In Jesus' name, amen. Thanks, guys. Thank you.
You know, there's a lot of stuff that's going on in the world right now. A lot of negative things. Things that we get caught up in. People getting sick, people dying, people's homes being destroyed. But we know that it's all right because we have a relationship with Jesus. We get to pray to him, we can talk to him, and we know that he's with us. We know that he cares. We have the confidence that he cares. So let's all stand and sing, "It's All Right." You know it's all right. 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 And just a little talk with Jesus makes it right. You know it's all right. 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 And just a little talk with Jesus makes it right. I once was lost in sin, but Jesus took me in. And then a little light from heaven filled my soul. You know it made my heart in love and wrote my name above. And just a little talk with Jesus makes it whole. You know it's all right. 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 And just a little talk with Jesus makes it right. You know it's all right. It's all right, it's all right, it's all right, it's all right. And just a little talk with Jesus makes it right. I may have doubts and fears, my eyes be filled with tears, but Jesus is a friend who watches day and night. You know I go to him in prayer. He knows my every care. And just a little talk with Jesus makes it right. You know it's all right. It's all right. It's all right. It's all right, it's all right. And just a little talk with Jesus makes it right. You know it's all right. It's all right, it's all right. It's all right, it's all right. And just a little talk with Jesus makes it right. Now let us have a little talk with Jesus. Let us tell him all. all about our trouble.
He will hear our faintest cry,
and he will answer by and by. Now when you feel a little prayer for yearning, as your heart in the heaven is turning, you will
with Jesus makes it right. You know it's all right.
It's all right.
It's all right.
It's all right.
It's all right. And just a little talk with Jesus makes it right. You know it's all right.
It's all right.
It's all right.
It's all right, it's all right.
And just a little talk with Jesus makes it right.
Amen.
As I travel through this pilgrim land, there is a friend who walks with me, leads me safely through the sinking sand. It is the Christ of Calvary. This would be my prayer, dear Lord, each day help me do the best I can. For I need thy light to guide me day and night. Blessed Jesus, hold my hand.
Blessed Jesus,
Jesus, hold my hand. Let me travel in the light divine that I may see the blessed way. Keep me that I may be holy, thine, and sing redemption song someday. Stand. As I onward go and daily meet the foe, blessed Jesus, hold my hand.
Blessed Jesus, hold my hand.
Yes, I need every hour through this blessed pilgrim land.
Jesus, hold my hand.
When I wander through the valley dim toward the setting of the sun, lead me safely to a land of rest if I a crown of life have won. I have put my faith in thee, that I may reach the golden strand. There's no other friend on whom I can depend. Blessed Jesus, hold my hand.
Blessed Jesus, hold my hand.
Yes, I
Jesus, hold my hand.
God, we want to thank you. God, we thank you that you hear us. God, we thank you that the things around us may be cruddy. Though life may just seem dreary and to a point where we just don't see anything good around us. God, we can know that we have you. We can know that it's all right because we have a God who sent his son into this world to die for us, to be buried and to raise again, that we can have new life, that we can have freedom from death and freedom from sin and freedom from things of this world. God, help us to set our minds on things above. Help us to seek first your kingdom and your righteousness, knowing that things in this world are going to pass away. They're going to rust. They're going to rot. And at some point, we are going to leave this earth. Help us, God, to be concerned about eternity. Thank you, God, for Jesus. And it's through him we pray. Amen. Please be seated.
His name is wonderful. His name is wonderful. His name is wonderful. Jesus, my Lord. He is the mighty King, Master. His name is wonderful, Jesus, my Lord. He's the great shepherd, the rock of all ages, almighty God.
This morning, as we think about the Lord's Supper and Christ's sacrifice, I'd like to read from Romans chapter 8, beginning in verse 1. Therefore, there is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus, because through Christ Jesus, the law of the Spirit of life set me free from the law of sin and death. For what the law was powerless to do, in that it was weakened by our sinful nature, God did by sending his own Son in the likeness of sinful man to be a sin offering. And so he condemned sin in sinful man, in order that the righteous requirements of the law might be fully met in us, who do not live according to our sinful nature, but according to the Spirit. Those who live according to their sinful nature have their minds set on what that nature desires. But those who live in accordance with the Spirit have their minds set on what the Spirit desires. The mind of sinful man is death, but the mind controlled by the Spirit is life and peace. Because the sinful mind is hostile to God, it does not submit to God's law, nor can it do so. Those controlled by their sinful nature cannot please God. You, however, are controlled not by your sinful nature, but by the Spirit, if the Spirit of God lives in you. And if anyone does not have the Spirit of Christ, he does not belong to Christ. But if Christ is in you, your body is dead because of sin, yet your spirit is alive because of righteousness. And if the spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead is living in you, he who raised Christ from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies through his spirit who lives in you. We celebrate at this time the gift of the one who sent Christ to die for us and who raised Christ from the dead. And we think of the power that it takes to do that. And that is the same power that, according to verse 11, has given his spirit to us. And so as we take of the Lord's Supper and we remember Christ's sacrifice, let us also remember the gift of the Spirit that's been given to us and the hope that we have as a result. Let's pray for the bread. Dear Father, we thank you so much for your Son, for his death, his burial, and for you raising him from the dead. And we are thankful for the gift of the Spirit that you have given to us, that even though we don't deserve it, that we have it and that we have life and can look forward to life hereafter. We pray all these things, Father, in Jesus' name. Amen. And now let's give thanks for the cup. Dear Father, we thank you for the blood of Jesus that was shed on the cross for us. And as we take of this emblem, we pray that we will remember the sacrifice that was made, the blood that was shed, and that we will take that into our lives as we contemplate the gifts that have been given to us and our role in this world. In Jesus' name, amen. We also want to give thanks for the many gifts that we've been given. There's boxes in the back if you wish to contribute. There's online ways to contribute. And let's just give thanks now for the many blessings that God has given to us. Father, we pray that you will never let us forget the many wonderful gifts that you've given, starting with that of your Son, but also the gift of the country that we live in, the talents that you've given us, the means that you've given us. And Father, we pray that we will always understand that whatever has been given to us is just ours to use and to steward for you. And we pray that we will give of those things that we've been given to build your kingdom and to help people in this community. We pray these things, Father, in Jesus' name. Amen.
All right, it's time for junior church. So if you've got a kid that's 3, 4, 5, or 6, head on out that way, and we'll sing them out. Are you guys ready? Get your lights out. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine where this little light of mine. I'm gonna let it shine. This little light of mine, don't you know that I'm gonna let it shine? Let it shine, let it shine, let it shine. Oh yeah. Hide it under a bushel. No! I'm gonna let it shine. Well, hide it under a bushel. No, I'm gonna let it shine.
Hide it under a bushel. No, I'm gonna let it shine, let it shine, let it shine, let it shine. Oh yeah, don't let Satan hit out. I'm gonna let it shine. Well, don't let Satan it out. I'm gonna let it shine. Don't let Satan it out. I'm gonna let it shine. Let it shine. Let it shine. Let it shine. Oh yeah. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. Well, this little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. This little light of mine, don't you know that I'm gonna let it shine. Let it shine, let it shine, let it shine. Oh.
Today we read from 2 Peter chapter 1, verses 16 through 21.
For we did not follow cleverly devised stories when we told you about the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ in power, but we were eyewitnesses of his majesty.
He received honor and glory from God the Father when the voice came to him from the majestic glory, saying, "This is my Son, whom I love, with him I am well pleased."
We ourselves heard this voice that came from the heaven when we were with him on the sacred mountain.
We also have the prophetic message as something completely reliable, and you will do well to pay attention to it, as to a light shining in a dark place until the day dawns and the morning star rises in your hearts.
Above all, you must understand that no prophecy of Scripture came about by the prophet's own interpretation of things. For prophecy never had an origin in human will, but prophets through human spoke from God as they were carried along by the Holy Spirit. Thank you and have a good day.
Holy words long preserved for our walk in this world, they resound with God's own heart. Oh, let the ancient words impart words of life, words of hope. Give us strength, help us cope in this world where us home. Ancient words ever true, changing me and changing you. We have come with open hearts. Oh, let the ancient words impart to this age. Come to us through sacrifice. Oh, heed the faithful word of Christ. Holy words long preserved for our walk in this world. They resound with God's own heart. Oh, let the ancient words impart. Ancient words ever true, changing me and changing you. We have come with open hearts. Oh, let the ancient words impart. Ancient words ever true, changing me and changing you. We have come with open hearts. Oh, let the ancient words impart. Ancient words ever true, changing me and changing you. We have come with open hearts. Oh, let the ancient words
In a few moments, our shepherds and their wives will be in the back for your encouragement. To me, it's a shame that so many times the only time we have some kind of, for lack of a better word, invitation is at the end of a sermon. I don't know whose this is, so I'm going to put it over here. And so, I want us to know that the invitation is always open. It doesn't have to be a shepherd. It doesn't have to be shepherd and his wife. It doesn't have to be the preacher. It doesn't have to be the youth minister. It can be a close friend. And I encourage you, if you're struggling with something, if there's something about this lesson that moves you, I'm humbled, and I will tell you that it's only through the ancient words that we just sang about. And so you'll have that opportunity 24 hours a day. But after the lesson, our shepherds and their wives will be in the back. If that's something that you feel so moved to do, go back and talk to them. We've had a number of people who have done that. And I'm grateful for not only you for being willing to do that, but also to our shepherds who are wise men, to their wives who have also brought them along and helped them in their ministries. And so that will be available to you. I'm going to approach this subject of inspiration a little differently than most preachers do. But that's okay. You'll hang in there with me, I think. Many of our national parks have a place called Inspiration Point. In fact, I started looking through and I found some things. Oh, holy words. I honestly only pushed the button I was supposed to. Oh, okay, there it is. This is Yellowstone National Park's Inspiration Point. Been there, and it's a beautiful place. And you stand there, and many of you I know have been there and taken pictures. And it's just a place of awe and beauty. Or if you go to Yosemite out in California, you stand there at the end of Yosemite Valley. It's called Inspiration Point. And you look down the valley, you see Half Dome on the right and Bridal Veil Falls, you see El Capitan on the left, and you're just inspired. It takes your breath away. I even found an inspiration point in the Catskills. I found one at Jenny Lake, wherever that is. I found one in Missouri. you can go anywhere in this world and find an inspiration point. So this got me to thinking, and I know that's dangerous, but this got me to thinking a little bit. My dad and mom bought me a Bible in 1968 for Christmas. And so I decided what I would do is look at the passage of Scripture that we often go to. It's a King James Version Bible. I decided to look at it in the King James Version Bible and look up our most famous passage on inspiration. And it says this: all Scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God may be perfect, thoroughly furnished unto all good works. All Scripture. Now, it's interesting to me, this passage of Scripture was used when I was a young man to prove that all Scriptures were inspired of God. And don't misunderstand me, I believe that. But if you really look at the context of this and you see all of this kind of stuff and you look up the word Scripture, it's over 30 times in the New Testament. But when you think about it, the word Scripture doesn't mean New Testament Scripture, because it wasn't even written at the time. And so here we go. We start arguing about things. What do we think about inspiration? Well, God wrote every word. Every word is inspired. And somebody else comes along and says, no, how can every word be inspired when you have all these different ways of writing, styles of writing, and you have all of these? And then we get into an argument about what's in the canon, what shouldn't be in the canon, and on and on and on and on and on we go, and we miss the whole point of inspiration of Scripture. It's what we tend to do, isn't it? We get into argument over things that matter. I'm not going to say they don't matter, but what happens is it causes us to not see what we're supposed to see. Everything gets lost in the argument. Then we never return to God to hear what He wants us to hear. In Genesis chapter 2, God creates the universe. I know what you're thinking. You're thinking, Jim has lost his mind. Well, it's not the first time. What does this passage have to do with the inspiration of Scripture? Hang in there, okay? In Genesis chapter 2, God creates the universe and He speaks things into existence. And it's amazing as you read the passage of Scripture there. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. The earth was without form and void, and darkness moved upon the deep. And the Holy Spirit comes along and hovers above the emptiness. And you read those things and you read how God spoke and they came into existence. But His crowning achievement, even though all those things were important, His crowning achievement was humankind. And it talks about Adam in Genesis chapter 2. And it says, this is the account of the heavens and the earth when they were created, when the Lord God made the earth and the heavens. Now, no shrub had yet appeared on the earth, and no plant had yet sprung up, for the Lord God had not sent rain on the earth. And there was no one to work the ground, but streams came up from the earth and watered the whole surface of the ground. Are you with me on inspiration yet? I didn't think so. Then the Lord God formed a man from the dust of the earth, or the dust of the ground, and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and the man became a living being. Adam was nothing until God breathed life into him. He was nothing more than dust until God decided to breathe into him the breath of life. He was an inanimate object. But by God's touch, by God's breath, he became a living, active human being. Now, let's go back to 2 Timothy chapter 3 and verse 16. The King James Version says, all Scripture is given by inspiration of God. The term really is not inspiration. In fact, if you translate that literally from the original language, it says that God breathes. God breathed into Scripture that it came. In fact, some of them really say he carried it along. And so when you read that passage of Scripture that says God has inspired all things, you could say God breathed all things. And so Scripture is something that's God breathed. And when God breathes something into it, it becomes living and active. It becomes inspired. So as we have all of that kind of in our minds, I want us to kind of go another direction here. And again, you know, don't write me off yet. Well, don't write me off at all, for that matter. There is something that I want you to see in the last book of the Bible. The last book of the Bible is called Revelation. Really, technically, the term is apocalypse, but we have translated Revelation. I know a lot of people say, well, what's in the book of Revelations? And there may be a book of Revelations in there, but it's really the book of Revelation. Go ahead and look it up if you want to. Revelation, or revealing, it's a revelation. It's something that has been revealed to us. Have you ever had your eyes open to something that you've never seen before? You remember those art things that you stared at, and it just looked like a bunch of stuff, a bunch of drawing of something, and you'd stand in front of it, and you'd concentrate on it, and all of a sudden, something would come out, and you would see it. And you'd say, oh yeah, now I see it. Here's a dinosaur. Here's a horse. Here's... And there was always somebody who stood there and said, I don't see it. Or have you ever seen something online? And I got to tell you, well, I'll tell you that in a second. Where you stare at something, you know, you have this image of Jesus or something else, and you stare at the nose for 30 seconds, and then you look up on the wall, and there it is on the wall. I had already written this and had put it in the sermon, and I saw something come up on my Facebook page the other day, and it said had a horse, an orange horse. And it said, if you stare at this horse, at that dot on this horse long enough, it will reveal your mood. And so what did I do? I sat there and I stared at it. And you look at the bottom of it, and it had blue and it had green. And I looked over at orange because it wouldn't change. I thought, well, it's not going to change. And the orange thing said gullible. But you've seen those things, haven't you? You've seen those things. And so you have these things that are revealed to you. Now, let me go to another story, this one from Acts chapter 8. In Acts chapter 8, there is an Ethiopian eunuch who is in charge of the queen of Ethiopia, of all of her treasury, and he has gone to Jerusalem to worship. And he is on his way back to Ethiopia. And Philip is coming along, and I don't know, the Spirit just says to him, Philip, go up to that chariot. I don't know if the Ethiopian eunuch had slowed down or what, but the fact is that Philip approached and said, do you understand what you're reading? And the eunuch says, no, I don't understand this. In fact, is the writer talking about himself Or is he talking about some other? And he was reading from Isaiah 53. And the Bible is interesting there because it says, then Philip began with that very passage of Scripture and told him the good news about Jesus. It pointed to Jesus. It revealed Jesus. In Hebrews chapter 1, it says, in the past God spoke to our ancestors through the prophets. By the way, isn't that interesting? In the past, God spoke. But let's go back. In the past, God spoke to our ancestors through the prophets many times and in various ways. But in these last days, he has spoken to us by the Son, whom he has appointed heir of all things, and through whom also he made the universe. And the Son is the radiance of God's glory and the exact representation of his being, sustaining all things by his powerful word. Now, let's tie these things together a little bit. In Hebrews chapter 12, he tells us, therefore, since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, let us throw off everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles. And this is the part I want you to see. He says, and let us run with perseverance the race marked out for us, fixing our eyes on Jesus, the pioneer and perfecter of our faith. Fixing our eyes literally means to stare at. He says, what I want you to do is to stare at Jesus. And as I've been saying at this point, you may be saying, Jim, you know, you have lost me. What in the world has any of this to do with inspiration? Remember inspiration point that we talked about at the very beginning. The beautiful scenes that we saw of Yellowstone, the beautiful scene that we have seen at Yosemite, and we could bring you up and say, what has been your inspiration point? What has been the place that has taken away your breath? Remember God breathing life into Adam? God breathes life into us and makes us from nothing into something. And it's our desire to have the Scripture, the inspired Scripture of God, take our breath away. When we see the way that God has pursued us, when we see his grace and his mercy, and when we see how Jesus has been revealed in Scripture, how can we not have our breath taken away?
Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. When I feel afraid, I think I've lost my way, still you're there right beside me. Nothing will I fear as long as you are near. Please be near me to the end. Thy
is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. I will not forget your love for me, and yet I'll forever be wandering. Jesus, be my guide, hold me to your side. I will love you to the end. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path.
Good morning. Jim, thank you for that lesson. It just fit together with a lot of things I've been thinking about all this week. And as I look out here and I see another source of inspiration, and that's just, I see all my brothers and sisters that all are on that same path of wanting to return to God and be with God. And we're in this together. And I'm just so blessed to be able to be here and worship with you, each and every one of you. If you're visiting, we want to welcome you. We treat you as our guests. And if you have any questions, if you have anything that you'd like to know more about us, please feel free to approach any of us. And we want to get to know you. And if you've been visiting several times, we appreciate you and want you to consider us your family and to think about doing that. Right now we have someone that is going to take that step, some new members. I'd like to introduce the Neese family. So if they'd stand up back here, this is Blake and Cortland Neese. And as you can see, they come to us from Oklahoma City. And as you can see, she's pregnant and it's going to be due in mid-September, so she's getting very close to another joyful time in her life. And just welcome them, and we're so glad to have them worshiping with us also. This was new classes today, and for those of you that just came to worship, I wanted to kind of really promote the fact that we do have some really excellent classes. One of them's To Truths and a Lie, which Franklin Wood is teaching right here in the auditorium. And John Kenyon's doing a class on Seeing the Unseen. And also there's a class, Life Lessons from Romans, back here in the corner. And so I'd encourage everyone to be able to take part of those, because that's for us that do want to delve into that word that we take for granted so often, that God's inspired and given to us. We also have wanted to kind of mention the together groups. We think that it's pretty hard here in a congregation this size, especially, but for us to get to know each other very much from just a few conversations before and after church services. So we like to really encourage people to get into some deeper relationships with one another. And we have several together groups, and we want to encourage everyone to explore those and contact them. We have an Andrews group, which is by Lynn and Susan Andrews. And they meet, of course, on Wednesday. Most of these all meet on Wednesday, unless I state otherwise. Bannister group, they also back in room 21. The White Hamilton group, I think they meet in homes, so if you want to join that group as well, contact them. And that's Jim and Martha White, and then Dean and Kathy Hamilton that are in charge of that one. Kieser group is the women's group, is Phyllis Kieser, and she, if you contact her, that's also meeting on Wednesday. And finally, we do have a youth group here, Caleb Smith, and it meets Wednesday here at the building as well. And we are kind of missing some of our youth here. They're out in a retreat at a camp, so we want to pray for their safety return. Also wanted to mention that we have a young professionals group that's just starting up. It's going to be led by Hannah Vogeltans, Aubrey Tate, Sam and Noah Helt, and they're going to meet on Sunday nights at 6:30 here at the building, so that this evening they'll be meeting, or check with them. It might be 19th, okay. I wasn't quite sure what the date startup date was, but get together with them, and you can find out more about the details on that. They do want it to be a group that are people without kids, so it's kind of in that section when you're in college and you're a young professional, but you're not quite ready for family, and so you're in that kind of life stage, and that's the people that group is kind of focused on. So if you're interested in that, go ahead and join that. I was going to also mention that the ladies' retreat is October 15th and 16th, so we want to encourage the ladies to be saving those dates back, and so please do that as well. One of the last things I want to talk about is kind of along the same lines as what Jim just spoke about, so I won't say a lot about it. In Hebrews 4:12, is what Jim talked about last week. And that's about the word of God is living and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword. And I guess that brings up the question, where is the word of God powerful? And a lot of times we find that the Bible ends up kind of on the shelf, gathering dust. And about the only time we hear it is when we come here to church on Sunday as the scripture reading and in Jim's lesson. But I want to issue a challenge to every one of us, including myself, every day to be doing some reading. It can be one verse, it can be several verses, it can be chapters. But I want to encourage everyone to be in the Word, because I think one of the things that God wants for us is it to be in our hearts, not up on the shelf. And it's not going to be in our heart if we're never reading it. So I encourage everyone to try and spend it could be a lot of time, a little bit of time, but I want you to spend time in God's Word, His inspired Word, this next week. And I think you'll find that as you go through some of your life struggles, God starts speaking through you through His Scripture. And I challenge you to come back to me if you've been doing that for a while and you find out that you say, I didn't get anything from God out of this. And I just challenge you to try it first, and then come back to me if you think that it's not working, because I think most of us will find that it does indeed speak to us. Let's go ahead now and, all right, surely.
Before you pray, Bart.
All right.
We would like to remember a young woman named Julia Waddell. Julia lives in Nashville. She's a young mother who recently delivered a baby 7 weeks early. She has now contracted COVID and she's on a ventilator. So Julia needs our prayers right now.
Okay. All right. Also, Larry Becker is still trying to recover from a fall he took. So let's continue to also pray for him. And there are several in our family that we do need to be remembering in our prayers. Will you bow with me? Father, we are so sad to hear about this young woman that Larry brought before us, and we just ask you to be with her, help her to overcome the COVID, and help her to be the mother she wants to be and be with her child that's so small and young. and just be at the doctors as they minister to both of them and give them guidance and help them as they deal with the many things that are hitting them physically. And we just know that you have the strength to heal us in physically, spiritually, mentally. There are so many ways you can heal us. And we just ask you'd look at them and know what they need and supply that to them in great measure. We ask you to be with Larry Becker and Tanya Harris and as they recover from some surgeries and from some falls. And we just ask you to be with many in our congregation that are suffering from various ills and things that just befall you in this world that we live in. And we just ask you to be with each one of us. Help us to lean on you and not to lean on our own resources. Help us to know that you are God and that you are truly wanting what's best for us. We ask you to be with those that are traveling this weekend. We ask you to be with the people that are starting school, the children, and be with the teachers and the children here at Southwest. We just pray that many seeds can be planted there and that they can grow in knowledge of you. And Father, just help us to use every opportunity that you present to us. We know that there are many times that we miss chances that you have given to us, and we just ask you to help us to open our eyes and open our ears and help us to see the needs of those around us and to be ready to serve rather than to be served. Help us to be the servants you want us to be. But Father, we most of all are just so thankful that you sent Jesus for us, that he was willing to die on that cross for us so that we could one day be together again in that glorious place in heaven. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Let's all stand and sing.
There is beyond the azure blue a God concealed from human sight. He tinted skies with heavenly hue and framed the world with his great might. There is a God, he is alive, in him we live and we survive. From the star God created man, he is our God, the great I am. There was a long, long time ago a God whose voice the prophets heard. He is the God that we should know, who speaks from his inspired word. There is a God, he is alive, in him we live and we survive. From the star God created man, he is our God, the great I am. Secure is life from mortal mind. God holds the germ within his hand. Though men may search, they cannot find, for God alone does understand. There is a God, he is alive, in him we live and we survive. From the star God created man, he is our God, the great I am. Our God who sat upon a tree, a life was willing there to give, that he from sin might set men free, and evermore with him could live. There is a God, he is alive, in him we live and we survive. From dust our God created man, he is our God, the great I am. There is a God, he is alive, in him we live and we survive. From dust our God created man, he is our God, the great I am.
Amen. Go be a blessing.